Hello, we are in the showroom at VirtaMed and we are very pleased that today Quentin Baumann from Amiens is presenting a part of his doctorate thesis, which was about our simulator. Thank you, Quentin, for doing this and have fun.
Hi, everybody. Thank you all for your participation at this webinar. My name is Quentin Baumann, French surgeon in the University Hospital in north of France. Sorry for my terrific French accent. Such a shame that VirtaMed did not develop any simulator for that. First of all, I wanted to thank VirtaMed and especially Majid and Martina and also Phil for this kind of invitation and this organization. Then I wanted also to have some few words about how my collaboration with VirtaMed started. If my memories are good, it was 6 or 5 years ago during the AGA Congress in East Germany in Dresden. And Martina was playing the simulators. And the first time that I used this simulator, I immediately understood the solution it could bring for residents. Thanks to it, residents can train themselves whenever they want, anytime they want, and without any pressure. And the second point is that the machine had also impressive feedback and recorded precious data. I was already convinced that the exploitation of these data would be a revolution for surgical education. That's why I'm going to show you with the conclusion of this study. The knee simulator is on the right. It is used randomly in orthopedic surgeon curriculum by the residents who have the chance to have it on their centers. On the left, it is the flight simulator, which is used fast monthly by pilots to avoid disaster in the aerial safety areas. The perception of resident training in arthroscopy was recently published in the OTSR. By questioning the residents, 40% declared that they would not perform an easy arthroscopy at the end of their residency. And 70% of them won't feel confident to perform alone an arthroscopy at the end of their residency. Paradoxically, 80% of the residents estimate that they will perform at least one arthroscopy a week in their future practice. And 90% declare that simulation is their favorite learning tool for arthroscopy. The simulation in surgery in 2020 is a major breakthrough in training. And this is particularly suitable for arthroscopy. It allows to know the variability of initial dexterity of surgeons in this field. And it also helps to better understand the learning curve in arthroscopy. The simulators training programs will be more and more prominent in training programs in the future. And this is already the case for the EPOS educational program. I remind that EPOS is the acronym for the European Society for Orthopaediatrics. But this is not only a tendency or a new toy in the educational arsenal, because it can be also scientifically assessed. The study of Howell showed that the arthroscopic skills learned with simulation can be transferred in the real life in OP theater. And these simulators can collect valuable user-generated data, which was previously unknown. As you probably know, the use of personal data is mainly used in areas such as geopolitics, e-marketing, IP tracking, or connected health. While the purpose of my study was to compare metric parameters and data produced by trainees before and after the EPOS arthroscopy advanced scope. The goal was to identify relevant parameters to improve surgeon training. The methods were the following. We assessed 35 surgeons with a perfect 1-for-1 sex ratio. They were surgeons from all over Europe, and they all had no previous simulation experience. Mean age was 37 and a half, with a large range. And we split the cohort into two groups according to their experience in arthroscopy. An A group, who declared to perform more than 20 arthroscopies per year, and a novice group, who declared to perform less per year. Remind that it is an orthopediatric population. The course was the following. It includes 7 hours of lecture on surgical techniques and 9 hours of supervised arthroscopic training on fresh specimen. Maybe at this time, Martina, you can show us what was the simulation. Martina?
So I have the company of Nick Friedrich. Nick, come over here.
Yep.
He was in our office today. And he's a very good knee surgeon, very known. And maybe he can perform the diagnostic that you did for your study. So Quentin did a diagnostic, unguided diagnostic one on our simulator in the beginning of the course and at the end of the course. And I would invite Nick to do the diagnostic maybe with commentary.
Well, we have, bonjour à tout le monde. We have the normal tools added with some ideas. We have the possibility to look into a knee joint. And as you see here, we can actually start with an outside view. It's going to be a right knee joint. So if we do an approach, we have already incision. When we are in, we see a knee joint as we are used to see it. We have the possibility to use the guiding probe. And I can test the quality of, for instance, the cruciate ligament. I can actually also work on the lateral compartment. I can probe the meniscus. This is all virtual, you know, there's no reality. Just a feeling when I'm in the joint, because there's a plastic model, I feel some. Can also look into medial compartment, posterior meniscus, part of the meniscus, the medial meniscus. And what I do usually is I start to guide the tour as we do it in our university setting, that we have to start the upper pouch. We can see up under the patella, quadriceps tendon, you see the patella, all the way up, upper pouch. So you can do a very realistic training. As you see on the screen, there's also the plastic model to be seen. Of course, in advanced training, we can take it away. So then you teach them how to do a diagnostics. In my department, there are 18 points to have to look at, like patella undersurface, lateral part, medial side, the trochlear groove, all the way down to the notch. And you may go up again. Go down on the medial side. Oops. Into the joint. And again, can you put it on? Again, the simulation on the screen. As a teacher, I can assist and tell him what to do. So I can learn how to look at the medial meniscus. and do a diagnostics on the anterior cruciate ligament. You see here the stability. You can also test the posterior cruciate ligament, as you see here. You can even simulate what sometimes you can do in patients, go all the way through to the backside of the knee joint, look at the insertion on the back of the PCL. So this simulation allows training to go back, look at the lateral side. Again, the structure which everybody has to look at.
So for the study of Quentin, the landmarks that I've written here were supposed to be seen by everybody, and they measured the time, the path length, and all the different possibilities that the simulator offers. And they did this before they started the course and after the course that was just described by Quentin. And Quentin can continue with his presentation, maybe.
Thank you, Martina. Thank you, Professor. Are you all able to see again my screen? Martina?
Yes, I can see
you. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, I can see your screen. Thank you.
Okay, well, perfect. Let's continue. So the simulator used was the knee module that Martina and the professor just showed you. And the exercise that we asked to the residents was a right knee joint exploration where 20 anatomical structures should be identified and probed. Sorry. Next slide. Thanks to the machine, we could have access to a composite overall score, which is based on the time required to perform the exploration, the percentage of visualized area of each anatomical structure, the arthroscopic movement saving score, including the distance traveled by the camera and the one traveled by the hook. And we also were able to know the percentage of iatrogenic cartilaginous damage done by the resident or the trainee. The same drill was performed one time before the training course and the second time after the course. On this flowchart, sorry, it is still in French, you can see the 34 participants who were all assessed at day one. Here you can see the main value of the results, the overall performance score, the time required to perform the exercise, and the distance traveled by the instruments. Then they all participate to the European advanced course of the EPOS. And at day two, they were all another time assessed. And here is the main results that I'm going to show you. Of course, overall performance score was improved from 199 to 203 points, which was significant. But duration of the exercise was impressive because it was significantly shortened from 185 to 115 seconds. Also, the camera probe travel distance shortened from 85 to 49. And for the camera, from 65 to 15 for the hook. We also noticed that the trainees did less cartilage damage on the tibia's cartilage. This table represents the analysis in subgroup according to the experience in arthroscopy. We will agree that it is impossible to read as it is. By using these color cycles, you can see that the expert group had benefits only on the duration of the exercise, who was significantly shortened. For the novice group, it was more impressive because the score, the duration, the distance traveled by the instruments were all significantly improved. Then, with the red circles, we are trying to see if the both groups were comparable at the beginning of the training course and after the training course. For sure, before the training course, according to a t-test, both groups were significantly different. But after 1 day and a half of training course, both groups were significantly different for the score, the duration, the stabilization, and the distance traveled by the cameras. The secondary results are also important. This table represents the analysis in subgroup according to this table represents the visualized surface of the anatomical structures observed by the trainees before and after the training program. On the green, you can see that some of the structures are perfectly seen before and after the training. For example, if we take the ACL, we can see that 90% of the ACL is fully seen by the trainees before and after the course, which is good. While other structures are insufficiently visualized, they are in red. This is the case for the patella, the trochlear groove, and the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. If we look at the patella, only 10% of the patella is seen before or after the training. There's a result. There's a result could imply a tendency to underdiagnose important osteochondral or meniscal lesions. Of course, This study presents an obvious memorization bias, which could have been overcome by a control group evaluated with the same free interval in the absence of training. On the other hand, no study has any interest in demonstrating that the repetition of a task improves its accomplishment. However, this is the first published French study quantitatively measuring the learning curve in arthroscopy. And this progress could serve as basis for comparing the quality of the various training programs offered to residents. Finally, the analysis of this data paves the way for modification in learning and surgical teaching. To conclude, overall score, time, and distance traveled by the instruments are the main parameters improved after this training program. The EPOS training program mainly benefits surgeons with little experience. And important anatomical structures are not fully seen, which is a risk of underdiagnosed important lesions. To conclude with the aeronautical analogy, the absence of simulation can lead to traumas, but with the help of well-structured simulation center in health, its reasoned and appropriate use leads to miracle. Here you can see on this picture the French president Emmanuel Macron visiting our simulation center in Amiens. And he performed a lumbosacral arthrodesis thanks to simulation, which is a miracle. Thank you for your attention. And if you have any question, I will be happy to answer.
I'm very pleased about this. Thank you very much, Quentin. So let's open the round of questions. I don't know if there's someone who would like to write down a question in the chat part, and I will read it out. In the meantime, maybe Professor Friedrich has a question.
Thank you very much for the presentation. As you know, in Switzerland, we are using the simulation also in the final board exam. The participants have to do a written test, an oral test. They have to do dissections in the anatomy lab, and they have to perform arthroscopy on the simulator, because that's the only way we can measure their capabilities. Is anything planned like that or already done like that in your country?
This is for the moment the beginning of a new phases in France for that, but we recently changed the modality of our residency, and now we have three steps, and the French Society for Arthroscopy is working on a proposal to ask to the residents to perform a simulation under arthroscopy to pass to the next step of their residency, which is a bit similar than what's happening in Switzerland.
An interesting thing is also we had discussions about, you know, who pays for simulation, who pays the price. And interestingly enough, patient organizations are very happy to hear that we train on simulators before we go to the patients. You know, we had some open days at the university, journée ouverte de l'hôpital, and then we talked to those patient organizations. They were very pleased to see simulation when we talked about the prices.
For sure.
They were happy maybe to contribute at some of the expenses.
Yeah, and I think also that the comprehension of the operation is a part of the results that we have with our patients. So if they can see what's happening in a simulation center, they will be more informed about their surgery.
So I have two questions for you. One question is, in Switzerland we have the lockdown, and we cannot go anywhere anymore in a hospital. But I know that people can train on the simulator and they use this possibility in Switzerland. Do you have an idea about training in AMIA? Is the simulator used or is the simulator center closed?
No. In AMIA, simulator center is still open. And, and for sure, residents are... The resident in surgery has more and more time to spend in simulation because OP theaters are closed, and on this point, this is a good thing for the resident training program.
Perfect. And the other thing is, I know that you did quite some more research. And apart from this, do you have some funny insights what you did with the simulator more than having a look about training outcomes and how to use it as a measurement tool?
I'm not sure I understood your question with the mask you had before your mouth.
So I will try to speak louder.
Okay.
Better. I know that this is not the only research you did. Can you give us insights what you did more with our simulator, because I know that you had fancy ideas?
Like I told you in the speech, there's the data that the simulators can record open the windows on a new world into surgical educations. It allows us to do new studies who couldn't be ethical before. That's why I'm trying to do a research about the impact of a night shift on the abilities and the skills of orthopedic residents. And so for the moment, we are showing that after a night shift, residents' values assessed on simulators are not so good that before the night shift. But the important point is that using the simulators after a night shift could also continue to can also help to improve himself without causing any damaging in the learning curve.
Very nice. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Quentin, for presenting your study. You know that we registered this, and it will be available also to you. And you and thank you really. Thank you very much. Thank you very much also to Professor Friedrich and to Phil, who organized all this. And hope to see you soon for the next webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Martina. Thank you, Phil.